Retaining walls are, as the name suggests, any wall that is designed to retain any material, which could be earth, water, solid waste, or anything else that needs to be retained. If you're an engineer inspecting a retaining wall, or you're designing one, or if you're a builder constructing a retaining wall, you should stick around, because in today's video, I'm going to cover the correct location of the steel reinforcement in a retaining wall and its footing, as well as I'll explain the theory behind it in an easy way to understand. There are a variety of different retaining walls. In this video, we'll look at one of the most common ones in Australia, which is the blockwork retaining wall. I'll be covering four scenarios. First case is a cantilever blockwork, where the retained soil sits over the base. The second case is also a cantilever, where the base sits in front of the wall. The third scenario is a wall pinned at the top with the retained side opposite the footing. And finally, the fourth type of wall is pinned at the top with the retained side on the same side as the footing. A retaining wall should be built entirely within the boundary of one of the properties and not on the common boundary like a fence. You might find yourself in a situation where you have to use a wall type number one. This kind of wall may be more economic, especially on sandy soils, because the backfill itself, acting on the base, is employed to provide most of the required dead weight. For this scenario, we can draw a plain frame like this one, with the vertical bar representing the cantilever stem and the horizontal bar representing the footing. The 10 kilonewtons point load in X direction is the resultant force of the active pressure due to the soil. The 10 kilonewtons per meter uniform load in Y direction is the weight of the soil above. We usually neglect the pressure loading from the soil below to design the hill. If we look at the bending moment diagram, there is a negative bending moment displayed on the tension side of the bar. In simple terms, if the bar is bent, the inside of the bend is typically experiencing compression, while the outside is under tension. Since the steel is there to provide tensile strength, if we look at the deformed configuration, we can easily tell where the steel reinforcement needs to be placed. Going back to the drawing, the vertical bars should be placed on the tension face of the wall, which is the inside face, maintaining adequate cover. The footing reinforcement follows the same principle with the main bars on the tension face. The starter bars coming out of the footing should lap with the vertical reinforcement, and it's a good practice to first tie the bars with the starters and then lay the blocks. The wall type number two doesn't have a hill, therefore the retained soil is not able to hold down the footing. As a consequence, usually overturning and sliding control the design. The deformed shape of the wall is the same as the previous scenario. However, since there's no soil on top of the footing, the applied load will be upwards from the soil pressure, and thus the tension face is at the bottom of the footing. The vertical bars will be placed again in the inside face of the wall. Nonetheless, the main bars in the footing will be placed at the bottom face. A mesh can be placed at the top face of the footing for crack control. A footing key, which is a deepened portion of the footing, might be necessary to provide greater sliding resistance, and it can be placed right below the wall, as I show here, or at the far end of the toe. Number three wall type is the case of basement or foundation walls for residential construction and larger structures. A concrete slab, depending on the stiffness, will provide a prop to the top of the wall. The connection between the wall and footing can be pinned or fixed depending on where you place the rebars and the size of the blocks. In this case, I'll consider a pinned connection at the bottom and the steel reinforcement for the stem
will be placed in the outside face of the wall. And this happens because now we do not have a cantilever retaining wall, as the top of the wall is pinned. As we can see, there will be a positive bending moment, therefore positive reinforcement will be used for the stem. Footings are usually designed in bending as wide cantilever beams supporting uniformly distributed soil pressure. However, since the wall lies eccentric to the center of the base, the footing will experience unbalanced stress distribution along the base. And this also applies to the previous walls where there is an eccentricity. I'm just going to copy the footing rebars over from the type number 2 wall, as they will be pretty much the same configuration. Make sure you have enough lapping and development length. As we saw in the 2D frame analysis, the location and magnitude of the bending steel reinforcement is dictated by the bending moment distribution. Note that the function of the reinforcement is to provide the tensile force required by the moment. The main vertical bar is now placed in the outside face. I'm going to lap it and cog the bar into the concrete slab. And finally, the number 4 type of wall. In this scenario, the retaining wall doesn't have a toe and the top of the wall is laterally restrained by the concrete floor. Instead of going through the frame analysis, which follows the same principles as the previous walls, I'm going to make a couple of comments that I believe are important. The first one, it is critical to construct block walls with the correct coverage reinforcement. And in a future video, I can show you how much the moment capacity of the block wall changes as we increase cover. Also, the block wall must not be backfilled before the concrete floor at the top of the wall is in place, otherwise your design is not valid. Or you can prop the wall if you want. Since this slab is restraining the upper end of the wall, the conditions for development of the active state would not be satisfied because of inadequate strain in the soil. Therefore, at rest, lateral earth pressure should be used to design this type of wall. And finally, the wall should be provided with a granular material for backfill, as well as a perimeter drain to ensure a dry basement and avoid future problems. So that's it for today. I'll leave you guys with a little homework, and you can leave the answer in the comments below. Also, leave a comment if you'd like to see a complete retaining wall design. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video, and I'll see you next time.